Let's have a discussion on item 5 in the agenda. I would like to remind individuals and deputations that you can use the headphone as zero channel is a floor. Channel number 1 is Cantonese. Channel number 2 is English. And channel number 3 is Putonghua. I would ask the deputations to speak in accordance with the prescribed order. Everyone will be given 3 minutes. I would like to remind deputations that the timer in the meeting room will give out a sound when you reach 3 minutes to remind you that your speaking time is up. You can actually look at the timer on the screen here. And those who have not yet given us your written submissions, please provide your written submissions to the secretariat after the meeting. I would like to remind members of the public that when you speak to this panel, you will not enjoy the electrical powers and privileges ordinance and the protection exemption. Your written submissions will not also enjoy the protection of that ordinance. And I would like to remind deputations and individuals to take note of the security measures as outlined in the notes for members of the public attending meetings in the electoral complex and those observing meetings in the public gallery. The notes have been attached to the letter sent to you by the secretariat, and the notes have also been tabled in front of you right now. And those who are observing the meetings in the public gallery can also get a copy of such notes from the security staff. Now, I would like to remind members that the public hearing aims to listen to your views, and there will be 3 parts to the public hearing. First, the public, members of the public can give their views. The second part is for the government team to respond to views made by the members of the public. And the third part will be for members to ask questions. In order that the meeting can be conducted smoothly, according to the rules of procedures, members should address your questions to myself. Then I will call upon the members of the public or the administration team to respond. And only after I have done so can you speak. Now, and among the government team and members of the public or government team and members of the electrical, they should not have a direct dialogue. I hope that you can abide by that. And also for members of the public attend the meeting, according to Rules of Procedure 87, I would have the power to ask those who are engaged in disorderly order conduct and members of the press who are engaged in disorderly order to leave the room. So all these have been set out in the notes for members of the public attending meetings in the electrical complex and those observing the meetings in the public galleries. So without notice, I can ask those who are engaged in disorderly conduct to leave the room. So first, I will ask the Undersecretary for Labour and Welfare, Mr. Casper Choi, to take us through the paper prepared by the administration, and then I will ask members of the public to speak. Thank you, Chairman. On this topic, for the CEDAW, it has extended Hong Kong since October 1996. It helps to protect women's rights and eliminate discrimination against women so that women can exploit their potential to the fullest. And for the state parties under CEDAW, they are asked to give effect to the CEDAW and report their progress to the United Nations in this relevant all these relevant aspects. The third periodic report was made in 2012 and was incorporated in the country's 7th and 8th report of the PRC, and it was scrutinized by the United Nations Committee in 2014, and the concluding observations were also issued in the same year. And this year, we will be submitting to the CEPG the 4th report, which will be taken on board in the nation's 9th report, and it will go to show the detailed the measures taken by the SAR to implement the convention, progress made in promoting women's well-being, changes in the status of women, as well as obstacles, etc. And we have started work on that front in accordance with the established practice. We are now conducting public consultation on the outline. We are collecting views from the public extensively. Earlier on, we have, together with the Women's Commission, coordinated two public consultation sessions, and we have invited interested party and the public to express their views. And the Women's Commission has met with various women's groups and attended meetings of district councils to discuss the outline of the fourth report to proactively gauge their views. After we have collated the submissions during the public consultation, including views given to us by the deputations and members today, we would carefully consider all the comments, and then we will try to follow up by incorporating them in the report. And then we have been using various channels to promote CDOB, including publicizing them through posters, roadshows, etc. For example, in public libraries, government buildings, MTRC stations, universities, we have also issued publicity leaflets on CDOB, and we have also organized some video production workshops for secondary schools. The government attaches a lot of importance in our work in promoting welfare of women. We have collaborated with a number of bodies, and we have achieved good progress. And the SAR government will continue to abide by the spirit of CDOB, and will continue to create an environment where women can exploit their potential to the fullest. Chairman, I and my team will listen carefully to your views and the views of the members of the public on the fourth report of on CDOB. Okay, the first one is Mr. Leung Kwok Hong. He said that he would abide by the CDOB. I thought he was speaking about something else. First, a lot of people said this. Well, they said that it's difficult to be a woman, it's even more difficult to be a renowned famous woman. There is this famous woman in Hong Kong, Carrie Lam. And regrettably, she has not escalated the status of Women's Commission to a statutory authority or body. And as a result, women's rights are not well protected.
Well, women are a suppressed group according to Oxfam's 2016 survey on poverty in women. Well, we have 614,000 women who are living in poverty. Well, that's a sizable number, right? And also in 2016, a report was released, some 640,000 unpaid homemakers, so 97% of those are women. So they are not eligible for MPF, they are not supported by MPF, which will support them after retirement. In other words, these women have become they have taken up the lion's share for elderly living in poverty. So we have some 40% of elderly who are in poverty, and many of those, so two-thirds of them are women. And since 2005, we've been asking you to set up universal retirement protection for the elders. Now some 610,000 housewives, they are not eligible for MPF, and they've taken care of their family and children, and right after retirement, they would have to become scavengers. So Carrie Lam also has her parents, so her mum is well taken care of. What about other people's mothers? According to the population census in 2016, well, Hong Kong's males, well, for the median income for male, that's 16,800, and then for women is 12,000. So there is a huge gap between the wages for men and women. Okay, for those who have a job, they are living in poverty, and those who are without jobs, they are also in poverty. And for those who are taking care of their families, they are also living in poverty. And Carrie Lam, as a woman, should have understood the plight of her fellow counterparts. enter as children, you should have filial piety for your parents. And for a celebrity woman, you should have understood the plight of your fellow women, and you should offer or you should provide universal retirement protection so that there would be less outsourcing, there would be protection for local workers so that women do not have to live in poverty. Okay, Under Secretary Choi, next time you should ask Dr. Lau Chi-kong to come and listen to us. Next, Ms. Chen Shih-yi, how come Lau Chi-kong is not here? He's just rubbish. I'm a representative from the Association Concerning Sexual Violence Against Women. All right, we have given a submission on the fourth report to CDOT. We'd like to just highlight two points. Well, if you look at the concluding observations by CDOT in 2014, well, with regard to the Law Reform Commission in Hong Kong, they have already come up with regulation on proposed changes to sex offence workers and so on. But then with regard to protection for children, that has not been completed. And then the Sexual Offence Review Committee, after 10 years of its establishment, they finally released a report or a consultation paper on sex offence against children and also mentally incapacitated persons and so on. Actually, precisely back then, in terms of sex offence, we are already 20 years behind other jurisdictions. That's why we introduced this consultation. But then up till now, the committee has been set up for some 12 years. Still, they have not completed that review. They have not yet been able to come up with amendment proposals. So the existing law has been in place for some 60 years. It's already very outdated. And we might have to wait for another 10 years before new laws are introduced to amend the outdated legislation. We urge the administration to help the subcommittee to come up with this report as soon as possible, and we would also like to have a clear timetable as to when that can be done. And also, in accordance with that timetable, the administration should also come up with a specific legislative timetable so that this council will be able to amend legislation concerning sex offences. And we can also see that there is an outline of the topics to be covered in the fourth report. So teachers would also be given training on sex or on gender awareness and so on. We are very concerned about sex education and also this education, because over years we have had this experience in terms of teacher support for victims of sex violence and so on. Teachers play a very important role. When students become victims of sex offense, very often teachers would become the source of help for them. And if they know how to deal with such cases, and if they can adopt a positive attitude, that would also make it easier for them to identify the victims, and also they can also become the window for such a cry for help. Well, back in 2015, Hong Kong's Federation of Youth conducted a survey on secondary and primary school teachers in promoting love awareness, and also sex awareness and so on. Over 70% of the teachers think that they had the responsibility to teach the students about such issues. Despite such awareness, despite the awareness of the importance of such education, over 60% of the teachers felt that in promoting sex education, they did not have sufficient support and they did not have sufficient teaching materials. And therefore, to ask teachers to teach on sex education and gender education, there should be more support given to the teachers. Thank you. Next, Ms. Chow Wing Hung. Well, we are from the Democratic Party, and we attach a lot of importance to women's rights. And these are the things that we've been striving for years, and therefore we'd like to take the opportunity to once again raise them. We hope that the administration will take on board these views and implement them. First, CDOT Article 11. On equality in employment and labor rights, women should be entitled to equality in employment, and there should be more places so that women should have more incentive to go back to the labor market. Well, for subsidized child care centers, the quota is not enough. And then for independent child care centers, if you look at all the districts, we only have about 738 subsidized child care centers. And even in 2018 and 19, in Kwun Tong, Sha Tin, North District, and Kwai Cheng, there will be 300 more places still. In five districts, there are still no service. And also for independent subsidized childcare centers, if you look at the demand for services, we're talking about 5,500 something, so it's very expensive. And then for private childcare centers, the cost would be even higher. So many grassroots women are not able to afford that, and therefore in the end they can only give up on their rights, and they would have to take care of their own children, and they would have to wait until their children are grown up before they can rejoin the labor market. But then after a few years off the market, when they try to return to the labor market, that would be very difficult, and without any support, they would become homemakers. And for many married women, well, in terms of the labor participation rate, it's been kept at below 70% for many years. And also, well, for occasional childcare services and also extending the service hours and also the neighborhood nanny scheme, well, in terms of the number of places, is still far from adequate. And if that does not include picking up children after school, then they will have to get somebody to help out in picking up or collecting their children after school. So there needs to be more support so that women will be returning to the labor market with more assurance. In many of the other countries, actually, there are more and more children who will be taken care of by carers other than their parents. For example, they would be taken care of by childcare centers. For example, in Denmark, for those under three, some are 81% of them would be using whole day childcare centers. And then in other Scandinavian countries, it's about 71%. And in Portugal, it's 59.3%. And in France, it's 55%. But then in Hong Kong, it's only 13%. It's very, very low. And also in other OECD countries, Hong Kong ranked number 29. So out of 32 countries, we ranked number 29. And then in Poland, back in 2002, they already set a target so that for those are under 33% of them would be using formal childcare center services. And therefore, we have to face up to this huge demand so that mothers will be able to return to work. Next, Mr. Wen Chi-ho. Thank you. I'm representing NT480, that's Anti-Sexual Violence Resource Center. Well, actually, if you look at the number of cases from the SWD, well, the discrimination situation in Hong Kong is still very serious. For example, for spouse abuse and also abuse of cohabitants and so on, well, we are talking about 96.4%. From our perspective, sexual violence generates from the inequality in powers and so on, and therefore to eradicate this completely, we will have to start with education. In many countries and governments, they think that education is a long-term solution to women who are victims of violence, and one of the most important parts would be sex education. A comprehensive sex education would not just be about physical health, it's about gender identity and so on and so forth. In that, for a very long time, Hong Kong people have been teasing themselves as to the fact that Hong Kong does not have any sex education. It's not like in Taiwan, where there would be a mandatory sex education. Taking a step back, well, back in 1970, we already issued a set of guidelines on sex education, but then it was revised subsequently. But then if you look at the new guideline back in 1997, right from the beginning, they said that in 10 years, there have been rapid changes in the society, and therefore we will have to broaden the scope of sexual education so that it can be done more comprehensively. And yet, if the government back then thought that in 10 years they needed to revise the guideline, but now it's 20 years since the reunification, how come we are still using the old guideline? And also, we've been talking about the word sex and so on, and also supported dating and so on and so forth. So I think these are terms that we've been using for the past 20 years, and these have also been the source of stress for many younger people. But then we've been told that Hong Kong sex education is still using ICQ as an example. Do you still remember what ICQ stands for? And also, our schools do not know how to explore what's meant by sex and what's meant by love. So these terms are just existing in name. So can we learn from the experience elsewhere? For example, in China, in recent years, they've already got some pilot programs on sex education. For example, the Ministry of Education of China said that you will have to set up guidelines, and through some universities like the Beijing Normal University, they're coming up with guidelines and so on. And then they've already got a law on sex education, and then Beijing Beijing already echoed that call, so that in some secondary and pilot schools, they already introduced pilot schemes, for example, how they can prevent HIV infection and so on. And all along, we never had this. And also for the Peking Normal University, they also introduced a pilot scheme. They talk about different sexual orientation and so on. We are still talking about gender equality in Hong Kong, and therefore we should revise the old guideline back in 1997 as soon as possible. Next, Ms. Lau Wing Heng, thank you. For years, whenever I read sex offense news, I would find it heartbreaking, because after the incident, the victim would not go after the culprit. They would just put up with that without airing any grievances. For many years, Hong Kong's women have not been fully respected. Yes, we said that there are different international conventions, and also the sex discrimination ordinance, and also the criminal the crimes ordinance and so on. All I can say about these legislation is that they are just existing in name. If you look at the existing legislation in Hong Kong, there are a lot of gray areas, and as a result, women victims, even if they experience such acts, there is nowhere that they can turn to. The only thing that they can do is to put up with this silently. They might go after the culprits through criminal legislation, but then if they have to deal with that under the criminal procedure ordinance, they will have to collect the evidence, they will have to catch the culprit, and it's very difficult to convict the offender. We also had the SDO. Yes, that has been improved, but then that would be confined to people of a certain relationship, for example, in the education sector, in the employment sector, and also in the service provider. For example, if a woman on the street, if somebody just came up to kiss her, then nothing can be done about it. So women are not protected. If we do not face up to these problems, then there will be more sexual offences, there will be more sexual assault cases. We don't want to see female victims to be repeatedly assaulted like that. And we do not want to see the victims choosing to put up with that silently. Because who has done wrong is never the victims. Because of the inadequacy of law, that's why the New People Party hope that the administration can learn from its past experience so that we can review the legislation. We should broaden the scope of the SDO so as to protect women from sexual offences. We are here to defend the rights of women so that there would be better legal protection for them. This is something that we cannot afford to wait.
Next one, Ms. Yim Kip Sum. Thank you, Chairman. I am from Action for Reach Out. This is an organization supporting female sex workers, and we have a history of 25 years. I believe that all of you would know that within the sex trade, the majority of the working people are the females. Well, the majority of us are female in the sex trade. So when we talk about women's rights and well-being and discrimination against women, we must face up to the trade and the situation of the sex workers. Now they are being discriminated against because of cultural values, stereotyping of gender, and a lot of it has to do with structural problems in our society. Now in the fourth report, I hope that my view can be incorporated. First, in 2008 and 2009, 10 sex workers have been killed, and starting from then, a lot more people are concerned about the safety of the sex workers and the legal position they are in. Now, Hong Kong laws only allow a one prostitute apartment. So that's why that we have this one prostitute in one apartment situation. But they are subject to violence, and they have been they suffer from robbery, and they got unpaid after providing service. So these are the incidents that's been occurring. Now, early on, we have been talking to the government and reporting to them on our situation. In the last CEDAW report, the UN Commission said that the government must abolish the legal requirements so that better protection can be provided to the sex workers. And that is in the recommendation paragraph 57E. Now, it's been 3.5 years down the road. The government has not done anything to amend the legislation on that front. And I urge that the government, in the fourth report, you must give us an update on the progress of your work. Starting from 2018-19, the Crime Prevention Bureau of the Police have regular meetings with sex workers support group. Two meetings are held every year. I believe that this work will definitely be included in the fourth report, but that these meetings do not suffice. And then there is another point. When the police enforce the law, there are some problems. They launch undercover cooperation, and they allow the police officers to receive masturbation service when they are doing undercover operation, and they use condoms as evidence in a high-profile manner, and this is interfering or depriving the rights of the sex workers. And I think you are depriving of the rights to health of the women if you use condoms as a piece of evidence. I hope that these can be included in the fourth report. Next one is Yang Oi Mei. We are the Association for the Advancement of Feminism. We would like to look at gender mainstreaming in government policies. CEDAW, one part of it has to do with how we can include gender mainstreaming in government policies. As a civil society, the year before the last, we conducted a study on gender mainstreaming in Hong Kong. We looked at what the government has done in that regard in the past 20 years. We have interviewed some legislators as ex-women commission members and also representatives from women groups. They all said that in Hong Kong, in promoting gender mainstreaming, the Women's Commission had done it with great difficulties because the Women's Commission doesn't have the authority to ask policy bureaus to give them a gender checklist. And very often, members of the Women's Commission told us these checklists have been provided to the Women's Commission only after much effort, and the LWB doesn't have the power to ask the other policy bureaus to have gender mainstreaming. They don't want to offend other government departments, and they don't have the relevant authority either, so they fear offending other government departments. Well, if they offend them, then the government departments will refuse future requests. So we can see that in promoting gender mainstream, these are the difficulties faced by the government. So in the CEDAW's report, I hope that the situation of the Women's Commission, as I mentioned, can be included. Maybe the government can consider whether you can empower the Women's Commission more. And then in temporary measures, Article 4, it says that the sex discrimination ordinance, etc., will remain unchanged. But the situation is very, very undesirable. It takes 3 to 4 years to have conciliation. And in 15 to 16, the EOC conducted a review on the sex discrimination. And it says that the 4 discrimination ordinances should be merged and new areas of protection in terms of age, gender, orientation, etc., should also be covered by the discrimination ordinances. Age discrimination should also be included. And these proposals have been made by the EOC and should be forwarded to the CMAB. I hope that the CMAB in this report can also mention this and update on us on the progress, give us the timetable so that the government, different government community bodies know that you're actually working on something. Now, for retirement protection, last year, the government has floated the idea of an annuity scheme. Well, thank you, Mr. Next one, Ms. Man Yi, Chairman. I speak on behalf of the Labour Party. I'm also the chairman of the CFU. In the fourth report, we noticed, or rather we hope, that the government can include the following items. The government can raise maternity leave to 14 weeks, as suggested by the International Labour Organization. It's a good thing to do that. Now, if that is done, the government must pay attention to this because there are a lot of casual worker, women workers and contract women workers, and they take up a large percentage of the working population. If you raise the maternity leave days, you must amend the employment ordinance to dovetail that so that female casual workers and female contract workers can be adequately protected. We know that a lot of employers, when, say, contract female workers tell them that they have pregnancy, then they will not renew their contracts. Well, even if they can last after the pregnancy period, they will be dismissed soon after they return after paternity leave, or their contracts will not be renewed immediately afterwards. So the law is wanting in that aspect. I hope that you should improve the legislation to plug the loopholes. In 2016, the CNS department gave us the figures. The male and female median income difference is $4,000 instead of $2,200 10 years ago, and this is so very undesirable. So this should be truthfully reflected in your report to let the UN know, and you should come up with specific measures to improve the situation. And also in the UN's last report, it suggested that the Hong Kong government should do away with the two-week rule of the FDH, and also they do away with the live-in rule. But regrettably, now in early this year, the government has put in more stringent measures on employment agencies, but the government has not worked on these live-in rules and the two-week rule. Now for this two-week rule, FDH are being exploited, and it's difficult for them to make reports if they are abused and exploited because 2 weeks is too short, and very often then they lose a job during this period, and as a result there have been few prosecution cases by the Labour Department. The Immigration Department said that they would use as discretion to allow FDH who are involved in litigation cases to work, but discretionary power is not enough. You should codify that such an arrangement so that the FDH can have more choices. Next one. Ms. Grocken.
My name is Paula Grogan and I represent Pathfinders. We repeat our comments in our written submission and use today as an opportunity to highlight our two recommendations under CEDAW's temporary special measures provisions at Article 4. Both of which relate to maternity leave. Recommendation 1. Pathfinders most strongly urge the government to take temporary special measures within the next 6 to 12 months to clarify and explain how a foreign domestic worker's statutory maternity leave should be handled in the best interests of the new baby, the mother and the employer. With the government itself forecasting that our majority female domestic worker population will increase from the current 380,000 to 600,000, taking special measures now provides a golden opportunity to ameliorate or even better avoid the dire and burgeoning humanitarian crisis that Pathfinders sees and tries its best to deal with every day. Pathfinders has helped over 5,500 babies, children and women because there is no policy or law that captures and protects this population, or indeed any preventative education to avoid it. We have been importing hundreds of thousands of foreign domestic workers into Hong Kong for decades. Most of these workers are women of childbearing age. How can it be that the administration have not thought about and provided for what should happen if they have their family while they work here? Recommendation 2. Pathfinders strongly urges the government within the next 12 months to enact temporary special measures to catch up with the rest of the developed world by updating its antiquated statutory maternity leave provision to 14 weeks. Please prepare an amendment to the employment ordinance and get it ratified. Dr. C.K. Law's announcement on the radio in October 2017 that it will take at least 3 years for statutory maternity leave to be improved is unacceptable. By increasing the leave to 14 weeks, Hong Kong would finally be on a par with China and in compliance with international labour organisation recommendations. If cost of the extra 4 weeks is an issue, then the government can consider applying its significant reserves immediately and on an interim basis, while the government then gets its legislative house in order through its proposed consultation process. We have waited long enough for this change. We can and should do better to protect the unborn child and its mother. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next one, Mr. Man Yun. Next one is Ms. Choi Ho Yi. I'm from the League of Social Democrats, Choi Ho Yi. The government has disregarded providing support to the grassroots women. This is a form of discrimination. In Hong Kong, among the poor population, while there has been a great gender pay gap, as much as 40%, very often women work in low-income jobs. For example, they work in outsourced cleaning work and casual workers. Grassroots women have to take care of their families. They can't work full-time work very often. And according to the employment ordinance, all employers can get protection. They have a right to join labor unions. They have all basic rights. But then for full protection, say paid leave, maternity leave, sick allowance, severance pay, etc., you can only enjoy that when you work continuously. So, in other words, for 4 weeks, for each week, for 18 hours before you can enjoy that. But for some women, because of their family situation, can only work on a non-continuous contract. And for some employers, they would like to save up costs, they use every ways and means to cut down on the working hours so that they can escape from their responsibility. And also labor rights are being undermined as well. And women are the unprivileged group and they're caught in the poverty cycle. Now, on women's poor situation in poverty situation in Hong Kong, the government should draw up legislation to help them. It can review the minimum wage so that the wage can really make people ends meet, and it can also mandate employers to afford more protection for those who are on non-continuous contract, and poor women. Very often only earn minimum wage. And if they have to have their wages raised, they can only rely on the one annual or biannual review mechanism of the SMW and also the childcare service. Now, poor women in poverty have to take care of their children. They cannot work full-time. And they need affordable government-subsidized childcare service so that they can really have their children cared for in these centers and they can go to work. Now, in face of such an inhumane situation, we're not doing anything. It is an insult to the women. The government has not implemented effective measures to improve the situation of women, and I think the government must take the blame. I hope that the government can implement more measures to help women in poverty. Thank you. Next one, Ms. Wu Meilin. Thank you, Chairman. I'm from the Hong Kong Women Workers Association. I would like to particularly mention about CEDAW's. The concluding observations say something about maternity leave.
So it's been said that it can increase to 14 weeks, but with increase in maternity leave, if there is no comprehension protection, then they will only be able to get four-fifths of their normal wages, then that would not help. In fact, that could also become a burden for these families. And also, in terms of employment, what's the relationship between employment and women in poverty? Well, if you look at the wage discrepancy between male and women, and men and women is increasing, and therefore you will have to look at the division of labor and also the industry-based situation. I think the Labor Department has a lot of responsibility, for example, in terms of social services and also government-subsidized jobs, where most of the workers are women, they are receiving lower wages, and also in creating jobs for the male, and also the constitution or composition of wages, I think women are getting lower wages. So that results in women getting lower wages in our community. And also, if you look at the wage trends, these are fragmentized. And I think the administration has a major responsibility. A few years back, when the Secretary for Labor and Welfare advocated that employers should be creating more jobs for women, and they call that housewives' jobs because they are casual jobs and they are not able to meet the criteria of consecutive 4 weeks and 18 hours a week. And therefore, they are not eligible for labor protection. That's why in promoting such fragmentized jobs, the administration is also giving us the figure. According to some reports, I think there has been an increasing number of working in poverty cases. I think that has to do with most of these workers being female, and as a result of these casual jobs that they are working on, they are still living in poverty. So when they work, because of the peace jobs, the piecemeal jobs that they are getting, they are not properly protected, and very often they are not able to make arrangements for their daily living. And also EOC under the SDO has already broadened the definition of a workplace, and better protection has been afforded to women, including those co-workers. But then there are also dispatch workers. For example, for supermarket promoters, the employers are not there. And if there is any sexual offense or sexual harassment, for example, if they've been sent to a supermarket as promoters, then they would not be protected. So these have to be reviewed. Next, Ms. Lai Shi-ying. Good afternoon. I'm from the Hong Kong Ladies Dynamic Association. We've been very concerned about women's health issues, and therefore Article 12 of CEDAW is about women and economic is about equality and access to health facilities. It says that state parties should take all measures to ensure that there will be no discrimination against women, so that they will be able to get healthcare services as needed. For example, including child giving or baby or childbearing support and so on. But then we've conducted a survey. Out of 1,078 respondents, only 8% of the respondents were of the view that the administration has provided sufficient healthcare services for women. And based on this finding, and also back in 2015, we conducted another survey, and the findings were very similar. It shows that women generally felt that government support for them has been inadequate, and for many years there has been no improvement whatsoever. It shows that the administration will have to work harder by improving its healthcare support for women. At present, there are only 3 maternity and childcare centers, so there are 30 plus some such centers. Only 3 would be providing gynecologic check for women. And in 2017, there was a survey. At present, we have already got some 4 million women population in Hong Kong. So there was an increase by some 400,000 compared to the last census. And if you look at the childcare centers and also a maternity care center, they were only serving about 60,000 women. So it's less than 1% of the total women population. So the effectiveness is doubtful. And also, if you look at the public healthcare system for women or gynecological services for women, it's just a branch for family healthcare, and it's also focused on birth or childbearing capability and so on. I think the policy horizon is very narrow. That's why we'd like to make 2 suggestions. First, there should be comprehensive healthcare service for women. There should be a comprehensive review on this women healthcare policy, so that you'll be taking care of women's mental, physical, and also social healthcare. And there should also be comprehensive integrated women health centers, so that appropriate information is provided, so that there can also be better education and guidelines for women, so that there can be one-stop service for women in Hong Kong. Second, there should be broadening of gynecological services for women, so that out of the 31 MDCC, there should be a gynecological health check for women, and the scope should be broadened, so that for women living in different districts, they should be eligible for such services. And also, the chairman of the HKLDA would also like to express her views on another article. Next, Ms. Lau. Good afternoon. I'm the chairperson of the HKLDA. I'm also a district councillor. To respond to an earlier point made by our association, Well, with regard to Article 11, it says that state parties should take appropriate measures to eliminate any discrimination against women in employment so that there can be equality between the gender and they should enjoy equal rights as their male counterparts. At present, we have the 10-week maternity leave requirement, and they would be eligible for four-fifths of their pay. Well, that was set up, or that was introduced some 23 years ago. It's no longer in line with the current situation. For women in employment, they are accounting for some half of the working population. Well, childbearing is very natural for women, but then for women in employment, in that process, they are subjected to unreasonable exploitation and discrimination because when they bear babies, they do not have sufficient rest, and their emotional and physical health would be affected, and very often their wages would also have to be cut. So we hope that some improvements can be made. And therefore, the LDA has made the following suggestions. There should be a brand new maternity leave system. It should be extended to 14 weeks. We understand that it's being rolled out step by step, and consultation is taking place. But then we should have a timetable for implementing that so that we can monitor the progress. And in the past, we have also had cases whereby women have not been properly protected. That's why we suggest that there should be a work right protection period after childbirth so that women would not be dismissed unreasonably, and there should also be better childcare services so that women do not have to worry about their babies. And we also hope that the administration can also come up with a family-friendly policy, including statutory holidays and also standard working hours, so that there can also be more community childcare services, so that between the workplace and the family, there can be a better balance, and that would also ease the pressure on women. Back in 1996, when we acceded to CEDAW, on the whole, the situation improved somewhat. Still, there are some measures that are still very backward. For example, on women's health and also on protection for women at work, we have yet to reach international standards. That's why we hope that the government can look into the situation and review the relevant policy so that women will be able to enjoy genuine equality in all walks of life. Thank you. Next, Ms. Ng Wing Lam. Well, good afternoon. Rain Lily is to offer help for women in crisis. Well, members of Rain Lily back in 2006 in the CEDAW committee's concluding observation, it already urged the administration to set up a crisis center for women who have been the victims of sex violence so that they'll be able to receive services properly. So the UN committee also confirms the importance of such a center. And also, after the administration, after the UN issued guidelines on support for victims of sex violence, it shows that government's support is very important. And also for healthcare and also legal services, they should also be provided at the healthcare institution so that there can be one-stop service. That's very important. But then, regrettably, if you look at the victims of sex violence support centers, if you look at their operation, they are not providing one-stop services for victims, and women will have to go to different departments to report their cases so that they can also receive a checkup by the pathologist. On one occasion, the victim was able to receive that checkup by the forensic scientists at the A&E department, but then it's very crowded and it's very congested, and therefore it's not the best location for such checkup. I hope that in submitting the fourth report, the administration will face up to this, and they should also respond to the 2006 UN committee's response so that a crisis center can be set up so that there can be one-stop service to victims of sex violence. Also, we'd like to comment on sexual harassment. At present, for sexual harassment under the SDO, you can report that to the EOC. Well, the EOC has been set up for more than 20 years, and all along they've adopted this mediation approach in dealing with all complaints, including sexual harassment. but then they would not be making any judgments, and mediation is done on a voluntary basis, and if the mediation is not successful, then they'll just close the file without any follow-up action. Yes, you can also seek legal assistance from the EOC, but then for cases where they can get legal support from the EOC have been very few in number. So after the mediation, they can only apply for such legal assistance after the mediation has ended. They cannot get immediate legal assistance while they file the complaints, and therefore that would also deprive them of defending their own legal rights. So while we are promoting equal rights and also defending women's rights, we should make use of this opportunity to review the terms of reference for the EOC and also cost effectiveness of its operation. Next, Ms. Li Wei-Men. I'm from the FTU Women's Committee. Well, with regard to the fourth report to be submitted to the UN Committee, we have the following suggestions. Well, para 62 and 63 of the concluding observations suggest that we should review the current maternity leave. It should be increased from 3 to 5 days. That's for paternity leave, in order to encourage male to take care of their children and family. And also para 51 to 52, it proposes that with regard to the Women's Commission, well, it should be upgraded, and sufficient resources should be given to the WOC so that it can have effective operation. With regard to the guidelines to protect women, the government's policy should be one that protects women's rights, and therefore women should not be subjected to discrimination. Well, Article 11 is about elimination of discrimination against pregnancy, and therefore, well, up to 6 months after giving birth, women should not be dismissed unreasonably. There should be better protection. And also, with regard to prenatal checkup, that should be treated as sick leave, and that should be treated as their rights. It should not be treated as sick leave. And also, for most women, after marriage, they would also have to take care of their family and family members. And with regard to the choice of work, they might be subjected to lower wages, and they might even be forced to give up their work. And under Article 11, well, existing government policies should be that they should increase childcare services, and in public housing estates, there should be one or two locations where childcare services are provided, and the NGOs should also be able to run low-cost childcare services without the need to pay rent. And there should also be support facilities for women so that they can return to the workplace. At present, at the workplace, there is no breastfeeding policy. And for women who are breastfeeding, they are not able, they cannot be separated from their babies for a long time. And then under Article 12, it says that the SAR government can conduct studies so that there can be flexible 8-hour work rule for women, so that within a certain period of time they would be exempted from overwork, and they can also decide not to go for outside work. And there should be two shifts of there should be two breaks so that there can be no less than 30-minute breaks, so that they can also prepare milk for their babies, so that they'll be able to take care of their babies while they are at work. Thank you.
Next one, Mr. Chen Hoikin. Good afternoon. I'm from Oxfam. Today, I would particularly like to talk about Article 11, Equality in Employment and Labor Rights. I would like to express our view. Now, before I do that, let me share some statistics. It's about participation rate. You see that the male participation rate, those in 20 to 30, 92% is a participation rate. Now, for women aged 39, it has dropped to 69.2%. You can see that after women have given birth, they have a low labor participation rate. We would like to make 2 points. First is about childcare service. We think that 0-8 baby aged 0 to 2 are most problematic. Now, we are lacking government subsidized childcare service places in Taipo, Kuai Ching, while 300 or 400 babies compete for one place, and there is even no such service in the outlying districts or outlying islands. Well, so you're indirectly saying to the women, well, you should stay home and take care of your children, and there are no objective planning standards for planning childcare services. It just depends on the needs of the different districts. And so we don't know by what criteria are the government using to build a new childcare center. So Oxfam would like the government to increase the number of places and extend the service hours. And also, the Hong Kong planning standards and guidelines should also incorporate standards for building childcare centers. That is, a certain number of such centers should be provided based on the population of the district. The government will be building many government complexes in the future. Should some, say, space be reserved in these complexes for building childcare centers? Or even you can even talk to the MTRC, and maybe in new MTR stations, such facilities can also be provided. So that's point number one. Number two, we talk about casual workers, females working on casual work. The government says that there are now 150,000 casual workers, and an Oxfam study is that it's close to 70% are female workers. Now, the women can have only two choices when they work, working excessively long hours, or they can work as casual workers who do not enjoy any labor protection. Earlier on, the manpower panel of the LegCo is supposed to talk about, in the second quarter of 2018, the continuous contractor issue. But I don't see that being put on the agenda item. I hope that the government can come with a legislative timetable on that subject, and maybe you can also study relaxing the relevant work hours requirements. Thank you. Mr. Lai Ming-chak, Chairman. I'm from the New Democrats. I'm a Sai Kung District Councillor, and the district, I've received a number of views saying that Hong Kong can do more to protect women. Now, in terms of policies, community support, etc., the government can do more, and the government should attach a lot of importance to promoting gender equality. It's not just about equal opportunities for people, but rather provide extra support for those in need. And many residents have told me that, say, when they are having pregnancy, they feel uncomfortable and they can't really work, concentrate on work, and they need rest. But if they have to take sick leave, they have to come with a doctor certificate, and their sick leave will be deducted, and they will be criticized by the employers, and so certain bonus will be deducted, etc. So they hope that the government can legislate on allowing women to, say, take at least one day off because of their monthly physical cycle. I mean, Taiwan and South Korea are doing that, and they can serve as reference. And there are a lot of young couples in my district, and they are very concerned about family-friendly policies. They hope that the maternity leave can be extended to 14 weeks. There can be more childcare services within the community so that women can go back to the labor market and contribute to the society. Say, in Cheung Kwan O, the childcare services are unevenly distributed in terms of the location. Some parents have to take MTR for 1 to 2 stations before they can use the childcare services. The government must come up with the right ratio of population to childcare service center numbers. And also, there are insufficient breastfeeding facilities in the workplace, and they are asking the government to amend the law to mandate enterprises to provide breastfeeding rooms and facilities for mothers. And in some shopping malls, there are indeed breastfeeding facilities, but then for some old shopping malls, such facilities are lacking still. I hope the government can consider in its own premises provide breastfeeding rooms so that the mothers can use the space. And also, in my district, there are a number of ethnic minority group residents, and very often the women in such EM groups cannot participate in economic activities, and because of language barrier, they are often being ignored as a group in the community. The government must work for them. Maybe you can provide translation services for them in the hospitals. Maybe you can even take the initiative to reach out to this EM group of women so that they know how to seek help when in need, and they will not be the forgotten group in a society, so that the government should do more. Ms. Jacqueline Au.
Stop trafficking of people or stop. I would like to thank the panel on constitutional affairs for the opportunity to give our views today. STOP is a frontline initiative that works to combat human trafficking in and through Hong Kong. We respond to the needs of victims through legal referral and social assistance, outreach, network building, and public education. STOP has made a detailed written submission to today's meeting. I would like to highlight 3 points from our submission. First, we call for the extension of the Palermo Protocol to Hong Kong and the enactment of a comprehensive anti-trafficking law. Human trafficking is a hidden and complex crime. Its victims include women and girls from vulnerable settings. As a frontline organization, we see victims struggle daily to access basic supports and legal remedies. Instead of taking a minimum approach to the problem and asking why we need a new law, we urge the government to ask why not and seriously consider the benefits of a comprehensive law, which would provide a clear pathway to justice for victims who are currently voiceless and suffering. Second, we acknowledge recent efforts by the government to combat human trafficking. However, we believe greater engagement with civil society would be beneficial, especially in the development, implementation, and monitoring of anti-trafficking policies. Third, we wish to highlight the need for up-to-date research and data collection on sex work and sex trafficking in Hong Kong. Negative stereotypes about sex work, coupled with a lack of understanding about sex trafficking, places sex workers in precarious situations where they are often arrested and charged during police raids. It is important to increase knowledge about sex trafficking and training for law enforcement to ensure victims are identified and protected. These 3 comments closely reflect recommendations made by the CEDAW Committee in its concluding observations. We urge the panel to specifically address and seriously consider these recommendations in its 4th report to the CEDAW Committee. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Au.
So members of the public have completed speaking about their views. We talk about different portfolios or areas. We have talked about sex offences, promotion of public education and the relevant support, and also women's rights, especially in relation to maternity leave, sexual harassment, etc. So can I now ask the Undersecretary to give a brief overall response to these points? Thank you, Chairman. First, I would like to thank the deputations for giving us their views, and the SAR government attaches a lot of importance to promoting the welfare of women, and we try to eliminate stereotyping and discrimination against women. A number of proposals have been made, so I'll make an overall response. On promoting women's rights, in 2011, we established a Women's Commission, and this was a very important central body, a mechanism. Over the years, it has promoted enhancing support and public education on women welfare. And for the checklist, in 2015, there was this gender mainstream checklist. Starting from that, we have asked all policy bureaus must take reference from that checklist when they formulate their policies and adopt mainstream gender mainstreaming as a principle. And the EOC is now implementing the SDO and is responsible for handling complaints regarding sexual discrimination. Now, a number of deputations have referred to the Women's Commission's work. We have strengthened our support to them in 2017-18, and we gave them $38 million. And we hope that in the next year, the Women's Work Commission will do more work. And in terms of parent support, a lot of women have told us that they have to take care of their family members, including the elderly people and children. And in this regard, we have adopted a multi-pronged approach. And there was this In 2018-19, there will be the number of parent support centers will be increased from 6 to 13, and it will rise further to 19. And daycare child service is also an important area of our work in the past, and some deputations in North District, Kwun Tong, etc., different districts, we will be adding in 300 more places. We don't stop there. On private plots owned by NGOs, we will also be helping them to increase such facilities in such plots. And we are also asking private enterprises to provide suitable facilities for women workers. In government buildings, we have also considered strengthening or providing more such facilities. And in Chang Kwan O, the relevant government complex, we are considering increasing by 100 the number of childcare places operated by NGOs. And also, in selling land, we are also taking on board the need to provide for welfare facilities. We know that the waiting time is long, and we've worked very hard to try to commit more resources to provide more facilities. As for retirement protection, we have done a lot of work in the past, including we note that, well, retirement is a joint responsibility of the government, the family members, and the individual. And in 2017, we have announced a number of enhancement measures, including enhancing the old age living allowance, strengthening the healthcare services, etc. Well, in the next 50 years, we'll be spending $60 billion every year on ALA. We will increase OAA or ALA. And for the second pillar, we are studying on eliminating the offsetting mechanism and driving down the management costs, etc. And for public annuity scheme, which is going to be launched in the middle of this year, we will consider how this policy can complement our other welfare policies. We are also strengthening the fourth policy in terms of enhancing our services on healthcare for the elderly. And in terms of combating sexual violence cases, over the years, we have been committing resources on that as well. For victims and for the culprits, etc., we are will continue our relevant services. And also, we at the SWD, we will continue to do public education work to raise public awareness on sexual violence. We will step up training for frontline workers and for family-friendly policies. This is also very important. Apart from encouraging different employers to be flexible in the work arrangements, we, in terms of the law, well, as pointed out by many deputations, the government is now studying increasing the number of paternity leave days from 3 to 5. We are working on the legislation and reviewing maternity leave. Well, I think it would probably go up to 14 weeks. Anyway, we have to conduct a review, and we will discuss the issue at the Labour Advisory Board and try to map out the details. In terms of the timing, we hope that in the latter of this year, some preliminary proposals will be made. Now, statutory minimum wage. Well, from the statistics, we can see that, well, the measure has enhanced the women's participation rate in the labor market. And I've heard your views about outsourcing work there for the low-income job types. You know, you may notice that we have established a working group to review the relevant work. We hope that in the third quarter of this year, the review will be completed.
Then many people have also talked about the 418 rule. Actually, if you look at the 1.5 million people who are working for no less than 4 weeks and 18 hours a week, well, actually, male would account for some 50% of that. Well, my figures might be somewhat outdated. So coming up, we are planning to ask the Census and Statistic Department to do another round of data collecting so that I would be able to get the latest figures. And once we have those figures, we'll be able to better understand which direction we should take in the future. With regard to foreign domestic helpers, we have some 370,000 foreign domestic helpers in Hong Kong. And you might have noticed that in the past, well, in terms of the standard employment contract, we have already afforded some protection for them. And in the latest version, we have already increased the fine for the intermediaries or employment agencies, and that would also provide better support for them. And you also refer to trafficking of people. It's a very serious crime. And under the current legislation, we have already covered the UN committee's requirements, so that for definition under the Palermo protocol, well, certain safeguards, including in a criminal procedure ordinance and also organ transplant ordinance and also pornography legislation and so on. In many pieces of legislation, we have already addressed these concerns. Despite the fact that trafficking of population or trafficking of people is not very common in Hong Kong, we will monitor the situation closely. And once we detect that there are any problems, we will see what we can do under the law to see if there is any need for us to amend the legislation. So I think I'll pause here. I'll see if other departments have anything to add. Yes? On sex offences, that the law is outdated. Do you have anything to add? And also for sex education, when it can be rolled out and what kind of support are you going to offer? Can you add to that? Yes, Mr. Zhang. Yes, Chairman. On sex offences review, as you know, the LRC is now conducting a review. And last week, they just came out to conduct a public consultation on miscellaneous sex offence. It's going to last for 3 months, and we're monitoring the situation very closely. Once the LRC has come up with concrete legislative proposals, we'll follow up on that very closely. Yes, anything else to add? Yes, on sex education, Chairman, back in 2001, when we introduced the curriculum reform, we emphasized that overall speaking, school education should be consolidated in a systematic manner, including other learning experiences and so on, in particular value education, and that would also cover sex education. We believe that schools should try to nurture positive values of students and also a positive attitude in dealing with problems, so that they would look at their own circumstances and situation in rolling out sex education. What's related to sex education, for example, personal growth, hygiene, and also adolescence, and also equality and gender and so on. Well, those have been covered in secondary and primary school curriculum, so that that's been infiltrated in the civic education curriculum. We also understand that for social atmosphere, that would also have an impact on sex education, and therefore we've been encouraging schools to use down-to-earth examples to be the teaching materials, so that they can also explore such issues with students, for example, love affair, and also intimate acts and so on, so that their personal growth would be more meaningful. And in order to support schools in rolling out sex education, we've been coming up with theme teaching aids, for example, online teaching kits. We would also be entrusting some organizations like the Family Planning Association and other universities to come up with teaching resources so as to assist schools and teachers to teach sex education. And we have also organized workshops and seminars, for example, at secondary and primary schools to effectively roll out sex education and also gender equality, gender mainstreaming, and also prevention of sexual harassment and also violence in a love relationship and so on. We understand that curriculum development is an ongoing thing, and therefore we'll be monitoring closely the community's views, and on sex education we'll be making a timely review, and we will also be providing support for schools, including developing some teaching kits for teachers and also training for teachers in order to help teachers to understand sex education developments, the latest hot subjects, and so on. Thank you. Other departments, anything that you'd like to respond to concerning the remarks made by the deputations and individuals? No? Okay, so the second part has finished. Now the floor is open to members' questions. Okay, some 8 members have indicated that they'd like to speak 3 minutes inclusive of both questions and answers. If there is time left, I'll give you a second round. First, Ray Chen. Thank you, Chairman. On Article 2, 5, and 7, I'd like to speak, and I'll try to confine my remarks to 3 minutes. First is about political participation by women. This time, nobody has mentioned that all along we've been saying that for the FC election, they have been the stumbling block for women's participation in politics this year. Other than the DC FC seat, only one woman has been able to participate. For FCs that are predominantly dominated by male, very few women have been able to join. So unless they are scrapped, we won't be able to ensure equal participation by women in politics. Article 5 is about stereotyping and prejudices. The report says that for discrimination against lesbians and also transgender women and so on, well, the administration has to face up to this and something has to be done about it. I think to do this, you will have to broaden the scope of the SDO so that sexual orientation and also sexual identification and so on will be protected in the 2016 report. Well, the administration will have to give a counter on sex identification law and also discrimination against transsexuals and so on. What's the latest progress and also the timetable in legislation? Last but not least, I'd like to focus on sexual harassment. The EOC said that different departments, for example, the Hospital Authority, the Security Bureau, the SWD, and so on, in collecting data from the hospitals and also discipline services, the basis would be somewhat different. And therefore, they've asked the administration to give an account on the accurate data. On such cases, are we going to follow the EOC's criteria so that the legal definition under the law would be adopted? And also, these institutions should be required to regularly publish such reports on sexual harassment. Just now, a deputation also talked about employers' responsibility when sexual harassment takes place. So long as the employer does not prevent the employee from filing a complaint, he has not. He doesn't have the vicarious responsibility unless the employer has not taken any action to prevent this from happening. He would not be shouldering any liability. In terms of promoter, for example, for a beer promoter, he's not employed by the eatery, but then he's employed by the beer company. And if the employer's liability is extended to the beer company, then, for example, for the promoter, her employer would also have to take measures to prevent this from happening. Well, I have used up all my time. I'm afraid I don't have time for the deputations or anybody to respond to that. Well, actually, in my functional constituency, there have been female candidates, but then none of them has been elected. Mr. Dennis Kwok, I'm concerned about paragraph 56 and 57 about people trafficking and also forcing women to become prostitutes. I'm concerned about that. Well, in a paper, paragraph 57, B, C, and D, have some very specific proposals for the SAR government to take action. First, comprehensive legislation to ensure that there will be a piece of legislation that will be able to comprehensively deal with people trafficking issues. I've also put forth a private member's bill. I made a suggestion on the policy, and also B and C also has to do with very specific measures. So will the administration be responding to that positively? Yes, Undersecretary. Thank you, Chairman. On people trafficking, I've already pointed out that there are different pieces of legislation to cover that, and I'm sure Mr. Kwok has also noted that a high-level working group has been set up to combat people trafficking and also to protect FDH, so there is a steering committee. But then for the task force, what's the objective? Undersecretary. Yes, I think I already referred to that. as Mr. Kwok just said, it will be addressing the issues that you've set out. I can defer to the Security Bureau to see if it has anything to add. Yes, Ms. Choi. Thank you, Chairman. Let me try and answer Mr. Kwok's question. Well, the Bureau Director is chairing this high-level steering committee, and the work objective is to combat people trafficking and also to step up our protection for FDH so that there will be policy guidance, and then we'll come up with the policy and guidelines. For example, on the action plan for the protection of FDH, we have implemented that to ensure that all policy bureaus and departments will have sufficient resources to effectively roll out the action plan. And this action plan's overall strategy is that there will be strategy to identify the victims, investigation, law enforcement, prosecution, protection, and support for the victims, and also prevention. And also to establish a collaboration relationship with all the stakeholders. But what about B, C, and D under paragraph 57 of the committee's concluding observations? Would that be included as part of the work objectives of the working group? That is, you will have to do what is set out in paragraph B, C, and D. Yes, Ms. Choi? Well, let me reiterate that Hong Kong's current legislation has already provided a comprehensive framework for law enforcement agencies. Sorry, I don't have time. So 57BCD, will that be part of the target of the working group? Can you be more precise and concise? Thank you, Chairman. We note Mr. Kwok's views, and there is a private member bill from him incorporating these suggestions. Well, for the recommendations here, we'll look into that very carefully. Thank you. Helena Wong, Chairman, I fully share with some of the deputations what they have asked the administration to upgrade the status of the Women's Commission, and the DP has been advocating for this so that it can be put under the CS office. I understand that the CS for administration is working very hard on youth development, and I hope that for the Women's Commission it can also be upgraded so that it can be placed under the CS office, or else we will not be able to make sure that the gender mainstreaming checklist can be done by all departments concerned. So that's point number one. Number two, I'd like to ask about Article 11. Is about equality and employment and labor rights. The DP has been advocating for this for years. We hope that the legislation can be amended so that maternity leave can be increased to 14 weeks and there should be full pay. And then for paternity leave, it should be increased to 7 days and it should be full pay. So when can that be done? Undersecretary. Thank you, Chairman. On paternity leave, well, we have already got past the LAB and will be coming to this council very shortly. And if we can achieve a consensus more quickly, then of course we can implement that more quickly. When can that be done the earliest? I hope that before the before the summer break, we would be able to table the legislation before this council. I hope that a consensus can be achieved as soon as possible, or else if we can only come after the summer break, and or if the Bills Committee takes a bit longer than expected, then that would be longer. What about paternity leave? We are conducting the review, that is for the maternity leave. We hope that in the second half of this year, we can come up with an initial proposal to be tabled before the LAB. What about childcare services?
Just now, a number of deputations have mentioned this. For women in poverty, maybe they have, it's because they have given birth to a child and nobody takes care of the child, and she has to leave the workplace and she is plunged into poverty and she can't find a job later. So you haven't been doing properly with your provision of child care services. I've got a surplus of $157 billion this year. So a deputation mentioned that 147 children are fighting for one place. Now, EU, the target for child care service is 33%. Will the government come up with an indicator so that you, towards which you can work towards, at least you can set it at, say, 30%? Next one, Mr. Jonathan Ho. Thank you, Chairman. Well, if Hong Kong's employment situation is like that in the civil servants, and that is 8 female to 5 male, but in Hong Kong in general, that's not the case. Women workers face great difficulties in the workplace. Now, if the women are to give birth to a child, their career will be cut off. It's just like joining the army in an overseas jurisdiction for a male. And in Hong Kong, the female workers are not supported. So we should have this he for she mindset. The government must do something. Will the government consider putting in place a protection period for women after they have given birth, say, major branded chain shops? The management would like to dismiss the women after they have given birth because they found that their capability may go down because of the childbirth. And the government is also reviewing maternity leave. I hope that the government can do something about it. Maybe women who are pregnant for less than 40 weeks can also enjoy paid maternity leave. And also for those who don't meet the continuous contract of 418, they can also enjoy maternity leave. Well, we should not see maternity leave as just a labor right. We should look at it as part of our population policy, because you want to have more women giving birth to more children so that we can have more labor workers in the future. Undersecretary, under the employment ordinance, where the majority of the workers, 95% of the workers in Hong Kong, enjoy the protection. But I agree with what Mr. Jonathan Ho said. My wife also is a working woman. I think we should do more public education, telling people that the care of the child should not rest solely on the mom, but the dad has also have to play a part. So we must strengthen publicity in that regard. Now, Mr. Ho referred to the review on the maternity leave period. We are proceeding with that right now. We hope that by the end of this year, a proposal can be made. What about protection period after giving birth to a child? Can you consider that? Well, in the interest of time, your time's up. You can't speak anymore. Ms. Alice Mack. Well, sorry, Chairman. We were engaged in another meeting, so we came here just now. Now, on this particular subject, for those deputations who have just spoken, well, actually, Mr. Jonathan Ho has spoken what I wanted to say, and how to protect women, pregnant women. And maybe the maternity leave should be extended to 14 weeks in line with the requirement of the International Labour Organization. And how come that we don't get a full pay for maternity leave? Why do the women, pregnant women, have their pay deducted? Why does it have to be four-fifths of the pay? Now, what is the rationale behind that? Now, Undersecretary, you are a dad yourself. You know that giving birth to a child is not equivalent to getting sick. So why are you treating sick leave days the same as maternity leave days? I hope that the Undersecretary, that you would not discriminate against pregnant women. You should think clearly the difference between giving birth to a baby and getting sick, and you should not mix up the two concepts. And then Mr. Jonathan Ho mentioned about offering a protection period for women after they have given birth. Well, the largest number of complaints we receive has to do with the fact that after the women have given birth to a child, they return to the workplace, they are being discriminated against by their employers. If we don't have legislation to protect them in that period, then it's not good. Now, Undersecretary, you talk about the length of the protection period, you are not sure about it. Well, but at least we're not sure about that, but at least we should have a discussion on that, on the length of the protection period. I don't accept your argument. Well, maybe we would suggest it's 3 months as a protection period. Others may be suggesting 6 months. Then we can have a discussion on whether it's appropriate. And you should not use that as the excuse of not knowing how long the period should be like and not start the discussion. No, I didn't say that. I said that there is going to be a review, and in formulating the relevant laws and policies, we must take on board the economic situation of Hong Kong and employers' affordability. And as I said, hopefully there will be an initial proposal presented in the latter half of this year, and women, labor groups, and enterprises will be pulled together to map out the best way forward in terms of the refinement to maternity leave. Now, 5 members would like to speak. I would draw a line here. There will not be a second round. And I will extend the meeting time until the minute when we are finished with our questions. Next one, Mr. Siu Ka-chun. Thank you, deputations, for coming. And I would like to particularly thank the Action for Reach Out, its submission, and their concern about sex workers. I would like to follow up with a question on the health of sex workers. Of course, condoms can minimize the health risk for sex workers, and that it will also minimize the risk for transmission of sex diseases. So condoms are very important. I believe that you will agree with me on that. But I noticed that for some condoms will be used by the police as evidence for prosecuting sex workers, and that if they don't use condoms, their health will be undermined. I believe that the AIDS Advisory Council has reflected this issue to you, but you haven't been responding to them at all. And must the police use condoms as a supporting evidence to arrest and prosecute the sex workers? The second question is about retirement protection. The Undersecretary has said something about retirement protection, but I think, MPF is one kind of protection, but then a lot of women are homemakers and they are not engaged in paid work, and they may have to work part-time or work as casual workers, and the contribution to MPF has been adversely affected. This is not the first time that we're raising such issues. You talk about gender mainstreaming checklists, etc. But after the checklist has been compiled, as the MPF, I mean, is still biased against women. So, I mean, what is the government's position like on this? Can I ask the Security Bureau to respond, Mr. Zhang? Thank you, Chairman. First, we have noticed what the member has said. In 2018, February, at the Health Services panel of the electrical, there was a discussion paper setting out the situation where the law enforcement agency seized condoms during the law enforcement actions. The law enforcement agencies have the responsibility to collect evidence that may be related to the crimes. And at the relevant discussion paper, we mentioned that the DFJ said that if we are to instruct law enforcers not to collect condoms at vice establishments, and it's not feasible because this may be relevant evidence. So the police officers have to do that. It's a reasonable approach. So, for the second question, maybe the Undersecretary can make a reply in writing. Dr. Fernando Zhang, well, I'd like to thank deputations for coming here to speak on CEDAW. We have been following up on the issue for many years, and the United Nations Committee has raised proposals for improvement in Hong Kong. But there hasn't been much done. Say, for example, labor protection. Some deputations have talked about 4-18. You have to work for 4 weeks in a row and for 18 hours a week. Only under that situation will you get labor protection. That's unreasonable. Well, for many casual workers, and many of them are women, this is this kind of labor policy is a discriminatory policy. I wonder when the government will improve such an arrangement. And then a lot of women, well, are actually women worker in Hong Kong are foreign domestic helpers. They number over 300,000, as pointed out by the Undersecretary. But the government has been committing very few resources to help them. As of today, I haven't found any dedicated services for FHD. Now, Pathfinders is one of the few groups in Hong Kong which raised funds on their own to support the FDH. Well, the FHD are foreign domestic helpers are human beings. They face a lot of different problems where they can seek help if there are problems. And the FDH have helped so many families in Hong Kong, and to a certain extent, they release the productivity of women in Hong Kong so that they can go back to the workplace. So who are helping them? And then for domestic violence, and there aren't enough places and shelters. And while the occupancy rate reaches as high as 80 to 90% sometimes, and the services are in acute shortage. I don't have enough time to talk about all the problems. And also, women of ethnic minorities, their protection is a problem because of language barrier, cultural differences. They don't get enough information. And a lot of low-income families of ethnic minorities groups don't get the public services they are entitled to. And then we don't have a good carer policy. And a lot of women are carers, and their work is not being recognized. And we now have a carer's subsidy, but then they are very nominal in nature, and the threshold is also very high. And the government must review on all these. Oh, well, they don't have enough time to respond to me. They can reply to me in writing. Next one, Dr. Priscilla Leung. First of all, I'd like to thank the deputations for coming here to give us your views on the issue of discrimination against women. Now, today I would like to focus on this particular subject matter, and I would like to ask the government. Women are very great. They can take care both their families and their work. And in overseas countries, I knew some Japanese women working in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and they said that even if they get married and give birth to their child, their positions will be kept for them for 3 years. And some women would like to take care of their children full-time after they have given birth. We would like to thank the foreign domestic helpers for helping our working women. But can we provide a choice for the women? Say, the government should take the lead, maybe. The women, because they want to give birth to a child, they can stop work for 3 years, and their posts will be kept for them until they return to their workplace. And also, will there be some job types whereby the women can work at home? Maybe the government can take the lead in implementing all these, and then the private sector can follow suit.
Workplace environment, that's the third point, so that for breastfeeding women, they would not feel embarrassed, and that would also not affect their work. And the entire working environment would also have to tie in. And for all these, if the administration can take the lead, you'll be able to take the lead in the entire society so that other employers can follow suit, and better support can be provided for women. And the second point, I'll be very brief, that is on sexual identity recognition. In terms of timetable for legislation, I do not quite agree, because when schools have to teach such subjects, you will have to look at the prevailing circumstances in Hong Kong and what's the local perception. I think even in overseas jurisdictions, it's a highly controversial issue. So I don't need you to reply. So on the first issue, can you respond to that? Yes, thank you. Well, for some emerging jobs and so on, they are more flexible, and we do encourage employers to enhance their support for women. What about the government? Well, the government has been taking the lead. As you can see, for newly built government complexes, there are already breastfeeding rooms and so on. It's not just the government. In fact, in the business sector, they would also set aside a space for that. In particular, it's so difficult to hire people these days. What about suspending their jobs while they stay home to take care of their families? Well, that will have to be a subject to further discussion. Yes, Elizabeth Quart, there are a few meetings going on in tandem. That's why I have not been able to sit here to listen to all the views. But then once again, I'd like to thank you for coming, and I'll be reading your submissions very carefully. There are several issues that I'm concerned about. First, on women being victims of sexual or sex violence. Well, in terms of sex offences, we've been reviewing that for a long time. So we have seen review after review, and we've also discussed that time and again in this council. Yet it is still being reviewed, and protection for women as victims of sex violence is still very inadequate. Just more recently, we had a 12-year-old girl who was sexually abused, and she provided oral sex to a male, and yet the male offender was not convicted because he genuinely believed that the girl was over 17. So before sex offense legislation can be amended, had that taken place earlier, then that would not have been the verdict for this case. And since 2006, you've been conducting consultation and so on, and yet when can we amend the legislation? Just a couple of days ago, you announced the miscellaneous consultation on sex offense-related legislation. It has not included sex abuse at the workplace, for example, at restaurants and pubs and so on. Well, people have been taking pictures of women's breasts at close distance, and also at the workplace, women are often sexually harassed, and also on MTL, some women have also been subjected to pictures being taken underneath their skirts and so on. And in this council, we also talk about women and employment, and also childbearing rights and so on. So we've been talking about how we can encourage women to give birth and also build their own careers. For example, in terms of reproduction assistance and so on, you also talk about equality and access to health services. In Hong Kong, we do have a lot of women who are rather senior in age, and they want to give birth. Sometimes they have to wait for a couple of years before it's their turn to receive the reproductive support services, and by the time they can give birth, they would become even older. So that so we hope to do something more for them. And also for childcare services, we have been calling for that for a long time, and yet even up to this day, childcare services are still inadequate. And in Sha Tin, 700,000 people, there are only about 1,000 or so childcare places, and also by primary school, childcare services are still very inadequate. And also for paternity leave, we hope that can be lengthened. Still, the administration has not responded to that. So all these go to show that the administration has not attached importance to women's rights, and also the impact on women. So it has not attached importance to this in policy making and so on. We hope that the administration can respond to those expeditiously. I'm sure they have noted that. My apologies, I've already drawn a line. Sorry. I think it's time for us to wrap up, because we have already overrun on the time. And in fact, I would also have liked to ask questions, and still I haven't got the time to do so. And we have wrapped up our discussion on this item already. Once again, thank you for coming, deputations and administration. And thank you for giving us your views. Thank you. Once again, I'd like to thank the officials for coming. Thank you. AOB, next regular meeting, 22nd of June, 10:45. So without any other business, the meeting is adjourned. Thank you.